Bosch sponsors Sunday Brunch.
Simon's just leaned past me and went, I love this item, Sarah.
And then if
you just tune in, this is Sunday Brunch. We are live, and Simon loves this item. I love it as well.
It's about art,
Tim. I love art.
Well, we'll see who's best art, won't we?
We're here with graphic designer and author of Why Fonts Matter, Sarah Hyndman. So, Sarah, welcome to the show. Simon loves this item. We love
you.
This item.
Yeah.
So, first of all, what is the definition of a font?
So a font is kind of the clothes that your words wear, where they're printed or when they're not handwritten.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
Now, your book, Why Fonts Matter, the obvious question, why do they matter, Sarah?
So fonts, they create a visual code, which is how you navigate, or all of us navigate, the visual landscape in our lives. They kind of set the scene a bit like other forms of nonverbal communication, so a bit like, again, clothes or the soundtrack in a film, maybe, and they set the scene and tell you what to expect.
So they market stuff. Yeah, they tell you about the stuff that you're about to do or see or eat or whatever.
Isn't it that whole thing that Omo, the old washing powder brand, was supposedly one of the best pieces of graphic work ever because it had two O's either side and an M, so it stared out at you from the shelves?
Yes, so it actually looks like a face as well.
Yeah.
So we're drawn to things that look like people's faces.
I thought FedEx was the one which won every time because it's got an arrow in there.
That's really geeky. That's because you know there's an arrow, but you have to have that pointed out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm a geek.
Yes! We made it! Big bang!
We've got loads of exciting experiments to do.
How did you get involved in this, by the way, to begin with? Why are you interested in it all? What's your background?
I'm a graphic designer.
Right.
I actually loved sweet wrappers when I was a kid. And as a designer, I work with typefaces. But for the last 3 years, I've been exploring how we respond to them, kind of emotionally or psychologically, through my own experiments and working with a few scientists as well.
Okay.
But I like to make it fun.
So, and this is fun. We're excited by this because we're going to do some experiments. So let's start with the first one.
So the first one is when you're walking around a supermarket, you get a lot of information from the packaging before you've even read the words. So we've got four cans here, and I would like you to tell me which you think the cheapest and the most expensive are.
So I'm thinking cheapest.
I agree with you on that one, Timothy.
Okay. Most expensive, I'm going probably this one.
Oh, I'm
going
to go the other one. I'm going to get that one.
Okay.
So, and how about which one has the most calories?
The chubby one.
That one.
Oh, okay. And which one would be diet?
The skinny one.
Yeah.
So most people would, these are very similar to the answers that everybody would give. And it's partly because we've learned all of these every time we go to the supermarket. This code of reference is being reinforced.
So were we right?
I've done lots of surveys. Your answers are along the lines of what other people would answer.
Because I would, this one, I was saying to Tim before, I have a little bit of an aversion to italics.
Oh.
It's my own kind of little personal thing. On my list of things I don't like, italics are one of them.
But fair enough. I sort of want to ask why, but probably don't have time.
I just don't know. There's something about it I just don't like.
Need therapy?
Maybe, you know, I'm feeling a little bit unnerved by the mention of italics.
How was your relationship with your parents?
You see, I think it's because always my dad would lean on me like that in an italic kind of fashion.
And it's slanted.
Okay, so that's interesting. Let's move on to what next? Menus. So, Simon owns a couple of restaurants, or more than a couple, you know, about
five.
30 of them now.
Wow.
So tell us about menus.
So there's been quite a few studies that have been done that show that if you find something a bit harder to read, you associate it with a chef being more skillful. So the recommendations, if you're coming up with a menu, would be make it slightly harder to read, but also if you use a serif, so the typefaces with the little feet on them. So these ones have been around for much longer. People will associate these with skill and with knowledge.
Okay.
And so of these three then?
So yeah, these two, one would be easier to read and one would be harder to read.
Okay, so this one's harder to read.
It's got italics on it though, unfortunately.
Yeah, so
I'd get a belief. I wouldn't even say in the restaurant.
So the theory would be this one, because it feels quite easy to read, people wouldn't think that you were as skillful a chef. Whereas with this one, they would think that you're much more skillful.
How interesting.
And this is using a sans serif if you want to convey a modern kind of feel, but still making it a bit smaller and harder to read than that one.
I always think of it, if it's an upmarket restaurant, you should put an ingredient in it which people don't know, because then they'll ask the waiter what the ingredient is, and then you can start upsell.
Always about the upsell, Tim. It's always about the upsell.
Kind of logic, something being hard to understand.
Okay, what are we moving on to here? Because we're going to run out of time, so I'm going to do this.
Should
we do this one first?
Yes, yeah. Okay. So this is, I've got... It. Yeah, please do. Yeah. I felt silly earlier. I look at personalities and typefaces, and I explore how we instinctively recognise different personalities. And one of my games is the type dating game. So I think, and I do find, that people instinctively know which fonts they would date, ditch, or be just good friends with.
Right, okay.
And so this is from an online game. So one of these is the most dateable male font, one is the most dateable female. Which ones
I'm thinking between these two.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
I originally went with that, but then I thought she's kinder.
You think?
She's kind of...
She's curvy and sexy, though.
She is, but she's beautiful inside.
Do you think?
She's beautiful. She's caring. Yeah. She's going to care about you every day.
Whereas she wouldn't.
No, she'll look great and be fun, but she's caring. Okay. What's the answer?
Number three is gender. But you obviously don't like high-maintenance women. You like people who are going to be a bit more friendly.
And what about the man?
Which one do you think would be the most dateable man?
I don't know.
I'm going to give eight.
Yeah, I'll go eight.
Okay. It's, in the surveys, it's actually number one.
I was going to go one. Yeah, then I thought, that can't be one.
All right, let's move on to this next one. This one's interesting.
So this, again, is about personalities and fonts. So I've got six different options. Pick the one that you're drawn to, turn it over, and I've written the personality analysis for you.
Right, we're running out of time.
I'm going that one.
Oh, I'm going this one. Okay. I'm a traditionalist who likes to think of myself as being modern. Oh, I am modern, yeah. You're articulate. Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
But not overly formal.
That's true.
Your friends often come to you for advice. They do, yeah. I'm an everyman, authoritative, incredible.
I think that works for me.
Incredibly good looking.
Mine, she's wise and a little conventional. Yeah, probably true. But I am actually forward thinking and not old fashioned at all.
Yeah.
You feel comfortable in most situations, from the relaxed to the formal. Key characteristic, intellectual, dependable,
and classic.
Classic.
That's definitely you. Never go for that one.
No. Isn't that the most hated font in that Comic Sans that everyone hates?
Your childlike optimism gives you a happy outlook. I hate these people.
I do.
But you frustrate that work colleagues don't always take your ideas seriously. Ooh. Comedian, friendly, novelty.
Pisces. Oh, they'll be Pisces, won't they?
Oh, I can't stand Pisces.
I can't stand Pisces.
This final one.
So another way I start conversations is I ask people to match smells to different typefaces. So if you have, maybe you'll try these ones.
Which one? Which two?
Whichever. That one and that one.
Okay.
That's fine. And then pick which typefaces you think they match.
Oh, this is hard. Yeah, that's really hard.
Mm. Don't think about it. Just do it really instinctively.
That one goes there.
I'm going spiky. I would have gone that one for...
That's exactly the same answer as most people give. And if I can reveal a little score chart here. So you associate sweet smells and sweet flavours with round shapes.
Yeah.
And also that looks a little bit like a logo. So you've also learned these associations. Chili, if you recognise as chili, you will match that to quite jagged typefaces. Because it makes you think of something that's aversive. Or you might match it to the Mexican style typeface.
This is brilliant. Associations.
Smell that. Take a really big smell. Oh, that's really made me laugh.
Did you say juvenile on your description?
Yeah, you should have picked Comic Sans.
We've run out of time. What was that one?
So this was just to explain that the round shapes we'd associate with being sweet.
Okay.
The jagged shapes with being a little
sour.
Bit jagged.
That's brilliant, Sarah.
So this is brilliant. Come back. This is great. My world is built around fonts now.
And your Bert Y Fonts Matter is out now. Brilliant.
Thank you. In just a moment, we'll be chatting to Lionbird. But first, here's a look at what's still to come on today's show.